I'm gonna call you, Z. Maybe tomorrow. Just after.
Or later today. Yeah, we gotta talk.
Oh yeah, we're gonna talk.
What's y'all got things happening at the job?
Oh yeah, because you retired. You probably don't care.
Hello.
Go ahead, Gail. You're on.
Hello, 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 and welcome to another edition of Sister Talk. I'm your host, Gail Talaferro, and we have two dynamic young ladies who are very instrumental in the show, the co-hosts, Marzina Sample and Marlon Wilson. You know you've been in the house too long when you start making your own sound effects. These are some awesome times. Today is Sunday, November 8th, 2020. And even though we didn't start off 2020 well, we are going to finish it off strong. How y'all doing today?
So good.
How you been?
Awesome. I'm fine. So since we have a guest today, we're going to go ahead and just move right on into the different segments. So we're going to look at Marzina Sample so she can motivate and inspire us.
Oh, gosh. So today, what I wanted to talk about is stop denying your feelings. Stop denying your feelings.
Speak.
There, nothing destroys self-worth, self-acceptance, self-love faster than denying what you are feeling, period. If you're denying these feelings and not speaking your truth, guess what? All this stuff is going on in your head for months, for years. That's why it's so important. It doesn't matter if someone likes your answer or your response. That's not your concern. You need to be in your feelings and know that they're valid, period. Otherwise, you're living in fantasy land all up in here. And come on, in this day and time, we do not need to be all up in here so much. So when you actually deny your feelings, it's pretty much like putting a Band-Aid on this big cut. So it's only this little strip that's okay, ineffective. Yeah, it might look okay right then, but hello, it's going to break. It's not going to last. So without going through your feelings and what you want to verbalize, guess what? You wouldn't know when you do well. You wouldn't know that you need to do something better. So again, get in tune with yourself. I'm speaking to the adults. I'm speaking to the children. And children more so, they need to do that as well. Well, growing up, we could probably all say this. We weren't able to express exactly what we were feeling. You get popped. You shut up. That's just the way it went. But look, we need to get these kids on the right track so they don't have as many issues as they get older, period. So yes, we have to encourage them to speak their truth and to say what they're feeling. It's important. Of course, it needs to be in a respectable manner, okay? Not them flipping out and slamming doors and all that kind of stuff. But again, we need to start this with our children now so they get on the right foot. It's so important. Everything that you think is important and is valid. So I just encourage everyone, find your voice, speak on it, live it. It's yours. It's yours. Again, it doesn't matter what Jane thinks. Who cares? Absolutely. It's all about you and you're expressing how you're feeling. Simple as that.
And you know what, Z? When I was little, I expressed my feelings a lot. Although I may got beaten for expressing them, it didn't hinder me from keep on expressing them. See, I used to say, Mama, brother, I would get it out. But sometimes my mom was a little quicker than I was. So by the time I realized that I shouldn't have said it, she already got me. You see, so those feelings, children, believe me, don't listen to the, if you're in a Black household, maintain. Proceed with caution. I don't care. I thought I was one of these other little kids, and I was like, blah, blah, blah. My mom said, okay, come. She said, come here, come a little closer. And I was like, Next thing I know, I see stars. I said, dear Lord, please don't take me now. I'll be good.
Oh, God. And it's funny, Marlon. I must admit, when I was younger as well, I didn't care. I spoke my truth. I got beatings practically every day, but I said exactly what I wanted and I would pay the price later. But yeah, what, Gail?
But we're talking about something different. Expressing how you feel. I feel sad. You hurt my feelings. I'm happy, you know. But when you talk about being, you know, smart mouth, yeah, that needs to be controlled. Adults, children, and everybody in between need to really control their mouth because it gets them in trouble. But we should be allowed to express our feelings. So if Marzina was to hurt my feelings, I could say, okay, Marzina, you hurt my feelings. And she can either say, well, tough luck, or I apologize, I didn't mean to, because I may have taken it a different way. And it may not have been the way that she was trying to communicate it with me, because I'm all in my feelings. One of the things that I'm learning is to get out of my feelings, especially when it's something that I cannot control.
Well, Gail, you need to talk to some of these parents, because I'm always in my feelings. And guess what my parents told me, as well as my elders? I don't care. What did I say? And so these feelings I have that I try to express and let little one child was not have. Listen, I come from a family where it takes a village to raise me, and that village done spanked me all up and down the streets of East Berlin, New Jersey. It followed me all the way to California. But so this is all I'm saying. Kids, proceed with caution. What we learned as kids is not the same now. These little kids just be saying any and everything.
Right, and that's why I stress.
You're not talking about feelings. You're talking about...
I don't feel like doing the dishes.
Expressing opinions. But if someone is hurt, yes, you have a right to say, you know, you really hurt my feelings. Mm-hmm. Marlon, what you're talking about is totally different. Because I'm like...
I would tell my mom, I said, Mom, you really hurt me. I'm feeling bad today. She said, I don't give a... So I did express my feeling. I said, Mom, my bottom is really hurting. Like, I can't sit down. So she said, oh, now you want to feel.
That's the cause and effect. Cause and effect. You call something to get that effect of getting yourself...
I have a good example, ladies. This is for Marlon and I. Gail, you really hurt our feelings when you decided to retire and then run it back to us every 2 weeks. You really put us in this place, okay? Is that a good example?
No, I was preparing. I was preparing you to let you know, so that it wouldn't be my leaving be so abrupt, you know, so you had time to mentally adjust to me retiring. I've been saying it for months. What's the summer? No, it's been a while. A couple of years?
Year, 2 years, maybe.
Yeah, it's been about 2 years. You were building up. then it just all took effect. Then the pandemic hit and you was like, I'm out, deuces. See y'all later.
You know, and I can speak only because I can see how I can retire. Like if I was to retire abruptly, like, okay, I'm working. I've been working all this time. Then I stopped working. I was like, ooh, what can I do to pass my days away? But since, you know, with the COVID and I was going into the office a couple of days a week and home, working from home 3 days a week, I'm like, you know what? I can really do this. I can, there's other things that I can do. But we're getting off subject. So don't let your feelings be hurt. Don't let your feelings be hurt.
That was just an example.
Here you go. Listen to this. Here's the rule. Don't let your feelings be hurt, or don't hold on to your feelings when you cannot control the situation.
And that's true. You might be holding on to something for so long and it's eating you up inside. And the other person, whatever they did, they're going on about their business. They don't know. If you don't express how you really feel and tell people how you feel. And you know, I learned that many years ago. Something ate me up so bad. I ended up in the hospital almost in ICU. Like, that's how bad the stress was, because my heart was shooting. And my sisters are like, is she going into tachycardia? What's going on? You know, so I'm on the air, on the floor and on the cardiac floor from stress that I just kept on letting build up. And after that day, I'm sorry to all my employers. I didn't give a flying hoot no more. So if I was going to express myself, I expressed myself. But I'm just saying, like, I would hold stuff in because I felt that I couldn't express myself. At one, I didn't want to lose my job, or something was going on at home in my personal life. And all that combined really took a toll. And I think it hit me the most. I said, I was only like 20 something. He said, you almost have a heart of a 70, 80 years old. I did a stress. I said, what? After that, you check my heart now, it's like a 30 year old. I'll be acting a whole fool. That's why I give myself the ability to act like a fool to save my life.
You know what? And you know what? I'm going to tell you something. That stress kills. A friend of my son is 33 years old. Last week, his friend, close friend from high school, well, actually junior high school all the way up, and they were still friends. His friend, one of his closest friends at the age of 33, had a heart attack. The stress kills, and people don't understand. So, you know, when we have an opportunity to let people know how we feel, and not hold it in and let it eat at us, and then we get resentful, and it can become a negative, feeling that we're just holding on to for no reason whatsoever. So we need to learn how to clear the air for ourselves. Because here's the thing, at least I can say, Marzino used to hurt my feelings when she used to say that my clothes was too big. She hurt my, you know, when she would notice that I came to work with my dress on backwards. When she knows, you know, my feelings was because I got caught out there, but, you know. Yeah, those are true stories.
Listen, every time you told me to put on lotion, I have no problems laughing it off because I still don't wear lotion.
See?
We can control that. We can control that. So, yes, as soon as your feelings was a shock, I can't believe she said that to me. But yeah, it's something that we can control. So let's control it and get it over with. But for the things that we cannot control, don't sweat it. Because if you can't change it, you just can't change it. Okay, so we're going to go on, because I'm quite sure there's a lot on Marlon's mind. So what's on your mind, Marlon? Oh,
listen,
boy.
There you go.
We have a guest. Remember, we have a guest.
Listen, I have another Cynthia story. Y'all are going to laugh. So my mom calls me in her room, right? her TV is like frozen, the cable is in, like, so I'm like, what's going on? So I said, oh, and she points. Now she tells me exactly the issue, but me not listening, I said, oh, mama, I tried to fix it myself. I called the cable company. The cable company is running all these signals. Every TV in the house is working. This is for like an hour, me and her going through this. Finally, I hang up. I said, mom, it must be your TV. I'm going. I'll go right to Walmart and get you a new TV, and I'll be right back. And I said, because I want you to, right? She said, no. She said, no, Dean, no. And she points to where the problem is. So I said, let me see how to, after an hour of being on the phone with, you know how it is with Comcast, Xfinity, you know how it is talking to them. Hello. They don't know what they're doing. You can read on a YouTube thing and find out better. So finally, I listen to my mom. I go and tighten the cable on the wall. Everything start working again. She rolled her eyes, got in her chair, and she just looked at me like, again, you're not listening. So the moral of the story is, listen to your parents. They know a little more than you. Even though I've gained a little more knowledge over the years, they still have a lot of knowledge left to give. Especially when they already know what the problem is and they just needed you to correct it. Now, I walked in her room and she was showing me the problem an hour before. I didn't call Comcast. I reset every box in my house for about an hour, running signals, doing this. And all I had to do was just listen to her. She pointed out the problem. So children, anybody listening, no matter how old your parents is, how old you think you are, they still can provide you wisdom and less grief. See, that's what they said. Hard head makes a soft behind. My behind, I got tired of sitting on and started walking around the house with the phone talking. But just listen to your parents. And that's all I have to say about that.
Okay. So I want to apologize. Listen, I want to apologize to our guests because I didn't have my chat function on. I never do. And he has made some comments, you know, so sorry, Yuri. so now my chat box is off. So, you know, it's interesting because now we know, we have a new president-elect. So we know Biden is going to be the 46th president. I'm like, there were parties in the street. Go ahead.
Can I tell you, okay? I was like, I'm not going to get caught up because then I don't go to sleep at night. So I didn't even entertain after third or after the voting day. I said, I'm not looking at it. I'm not looking at it until it's done. And that did help me, but I was so anxious. But anyway, yeah, I was so ecstatic yesterday. Like, what? And I didn't work myself up just as much as usual, you know. But it's just crazy that in some states it was so close. I didn't quite get that. I didn't get that at all.
I think what it is they already know how many votes have to come in for that individual to take the state. I mean, I don't know. I don't know how it is. But every state knows how many registered voters they have. They count how many ballots they have and how many is coming in. So they know. I think this is me. Like, I'm not an analyst or anything. So when they see a certain number of votes come in, they already know at what point. But because our ex-orange man wanted them to count every vote because he said it was going to be. See, what happened is all the Republicans ran out, stood in line, everything. Democrats mailed their votes in and everything. Yeah, if we would have stopped counting the votes early, he probably would have took some states. But because of what he put into office for every vote to be counted, he kicked himself in the behind. We didn't do it. But I think what it is they all have a list of how many registered voters are in the state and the percentage. What do you need? Like 80% to take the state? I'm not sure. So once they get to the president-elect has 80%, I think they just give it to them. I don't know.
But you know, crazy. They choose by, but what happens is, you know, there's electoral votes, and right. that's what they go by, the electoral votes. And this is why the census is so important, because the more people who you have registered, listed in a population, in a segregated population, they will determine the electoral votes based on, you know, how many people are in a certain area. So, you know, that's why it's so important to make sure that people send back their census form so that they can be counted, because there's a lot that's looked into with that, how many hospitals are needed in a certain, you know, area or town or what have you, if they need extra transportation for buses and schools, and all that stuff plays a part when it talks about the census. So as well as the electoral votes. But you know, Trump is out, and I had the nerve. I turned on CNN this morning, and Trump was doing a photo shoot, and he had on army fatigue pants, and he had on an orange shirt, taking pictures. And I'm like, what is he doing? Is he planning on calling his, you know, people from the woods, out of the mountains, to come on down and start some ruckus? You know, I'm like, yeah. I'm like, so we don't know. He hasn't conceded yet, not since the last time that I checked the news.
He's not going to. He's putting out frivolous lawsuits against the people, and he's even turning on his own Republican Party. Some of the states are Republican states that he's mm-hmm. putting these lawsuits against, and they're coming out saying, "Look, it's frivolous." Right now, if you continue to watch CNN, it shows he's at 290. Trump, concede. There's no more you can do. The people have spoken. When did he must have failed to realize, you know what? I was telling my aunt this last night. Trump didn't do that much. He didn't realize that Biden maybe have done more than he did in regards to getting out there speaking to the people. And what did I tell her? I told her something like, I guess the blacks finally realized how much he really did for them. He said he did so much for us. So I guess he found out he didn't do enough.
Here's the thing, because we had to go through this process. We had to have Obama president, okay, 2 terms, okay? And you know, they did not want a black president. We know that many people did not want a black president, you know. And then Trump had to be in office so that people can see where people's heart is. You know, they can see true, okay, oh, you don't like black people. Oh, you want to keep the separation of the classes. All of this stuff had to be revealed so that Biden can come in and heal the land. That's one of the things that he wants to do. He wants to heal the land, but that stuff had to be revealed. We had to see the bigotry. We had to see the discrimination. You know what I mean? And Trayvon Martin, you know, that's one of the things that stands out, that, you know, now something's going to happen from his death and the others, because under Trump, no, but there will be some kind of a reform. The thing is, there had to be losses in order for us to move forward.
But can I say this? It was so historical that we have a black woman, and please, I hope I'm pronouncing her name right. Kamala Harris. I am so happy for this moment to see a black woman stand and represent. You know, it was just historical. We understand that she has done some things in the past. We absolutely do. But if her and Biden work together to make change, change can come. People learn from their mistakes.
Definitely.
Both of them are in office, that they learn what could happen, and you know, it has happened, and use that as a tool to improve upon how America is run, how people are treated within the United States, and build on that. We understand racism is not going to end overnight. Racism, and they're going to continue to be people like that. But with the help of our elected officials and others, we can lessen the impact that it has on our daily lives. So I really just want to, this historical moment is just, I mean, when I see my mom cry when they announced who the new president was, and when she seen Kamala come up there and make her speech, that speech was beautiful in my opinion. And it does give kids a hope that they can and they will someday be something more than what they are today. And so I just want to just embrace this historical moment. And I want to say congratulations to Joe Biden and Kamala Harris on the job. Well, and hopefully they will do a good job.
Yes. And you know that,
but you know what? It just shows. Go ahead, Marzina.
Oh, I was just saying, you know, you said it hadn't been, even with Obama, more people voted this time around. So that's record breaking right there. I mean, people were crying, and I get it, because we have been in such a bad place over the past 4 years. It's ridiculous. So, I'm just happy.
Hold on to that, because it's not over, you know, as far as what we go through within the next year and a half. But what this race represent was, you know, especially for people of color, that we are all, this is a big melting pot. You know, and you have people who are mixed with nationalities, races, creeds, colors, you know, and this just proves that, you know, even someone who is non-white can make a difference and be in the White House and serve. So that's the whole thing, non-white, because it's not just about white people. It's not just about Black people. Yep. It's about everybody having the ability to achieve any goals that they set forth for themselves to make a difference in our society, our household, community, society, and our nation.
And if you looked at our post that we posted, go vote, it matters. And people can see their vote really did matter in this election and how it turned things around. Because when we were looking at red, blue, was just, some of these states were held by Republicans for years. To see them flip to a blue state was just, that's historical in itself. So, I mean, I hope that just doesn't limit people. They come out once. I want everybody to continue to vote. Continue to make sure that the right leaders are placed in office, and make sure you know who your leaders are and how they're going to represent you. So even though you might not agree with something, if they represent what you're feeling, go for it. Because Z, who you might vote for, is not who I might not vote for. What you might need in your life, I might need. But understand, when you vote, that means you're doing something to make a change. And that nobody can change, and as long as you keep on going at it, you will make a change someday. Change is always happening. It's happening slowly, but it will happen. We have to look go back in history and see how our ancestors and everything fought to make changes. They were united, not only as one, they united as a nation to make change. They put in laws in place. So we have to take the time to really look at our officials, make sure that we understand what we're doing when we elect certain individuals, and that our voice will be heard. You want somebody who will express how we feel in life so that we can live the life that we want to live comfortably, without having fear of walking out, without having fear with sending our sons and daughters outside and praying that they make it home. Make sure that the laws are in place to protect and serve the community. You know what I'm saying? Don't have a bias law. Well, you know what? I'm going off on a tangent. So
no, but it's true. It's true. And it's excellent points, Marlon. Just like we were saying last month, how people think their voice doesn't matter, but they are passing all these laws right under our noses. And we don't know what's going on because we don't feel we should get involved. If you pay taxes, it's going to affect you. So people, come on. We got to get it together and keep it together. This is
important. Our guest made some comments. He said, totally historical and exactly. See, I'm paying somewhat attention. I'm paying some.
Well, God, we have time to introduce our guest.
Yes. It is so now, the second so where you go.
I have known our guest his whole life. Is my cousin. He is a trainer. I hope I get this right. He's a trainer. He's a poet. He has done spoken word. He has put out a book as well as he has put out a CD. He does spoken word. He did spoken word. He's been doing it for a while. Let's just bring him on and he could tell us a little more about himself. And Yarel, how are you doing? You can come in if you can hear us.
Hi, Yarel.
Hey, guys.
Hi. There you go.
You guys are having a wonderful conversation, and I'm just chiming in on the chat, but it's amazing time in history. So thank you for that introduction. You guys have so many great points. And with this time, I wanted to give hope, more hope to people that we are on the right direction. We're doing the right things. We're listening to everyone. And that's very important, to listen to everyone. Everyone has a different experience. So I'm a fitness trainer and yoga instructor, spoken word artist. I've traveled around the world working with athletes and working with non-athletes. And from the yoga and fitness, I devised a healing program, which I call Your Healing. And it's assisted stretching to all the major muscles with pressure points to the hands and to the feet, all based in diaphragmatic breathing, causes a healing process in the body. So we've been able to, it boosts the metabolism, it makes you more functional. And it's like, just like an overall body tune-up or in the body. I devised that from stretching all my clients before the workouts. It would enhance their workouts and make it a lot easier, as well as it omits them from injury. You know, it helps them stay safe during the workouts. So,
where are you located?
That's my purpose.
Where are you located?
I am in Los Angeles, California. It's amazing. This is a beautiful, beautiful place. And there's, you know, this is the media capital of the world. I was told the other day, and this is very, very deep, but it's the sixth biggest economy. Just this state is the sixth biggest economy amongst the world's economies. So, you know, there's a lot of opportunity out here. It never rains. Just like Tony Tone said, look, it's awesome. It's really beautiful.
Now, Yarel, I know that you've been working at this for a while. You've been doing your spoken word and you've been doing your healing. What keeps you motivated and going as you continue? What inspires you to do what you do?
I want the best for the people. I want the best for our family. I want the best for everyone. I'm always about that. I use my poetry as motivational speaking because I feel there always has to be someone that has that voice of positivity. I try to be the change in the world that I want to see.
Nice. Do you have anything prepared that you could give us a sample of today?
Oh man, I have loads. Here's my chart that I devised. It's a reflexology zone therapy chart. This is what I use for the hands and feet. Now, our hands and our feet look different than every part of the body, because they are where your nerve endings are. And those nerve endings are basically the endpoints of wherever you feel from. So you can contact literally every part of the body just through the hands or the feet. That's why you see they look with the lines, all of them. Those are actually different parts and segments of your body. So what this chart does is it tells you where everything is located. Now, the difference in my chart and most people's charts is that I actually have a combination codes, if you will, of how to say, you know, relief back pain, arthritis, allergies, and how it's connected to the body.
But I think we were referring to some spoken word.
Let's do it.
No, I learned with that part too. I did not know.
But
everything is connected to hands and feet. I didn't know that. So I appreciate that part too.
We do appreciate that because it is a part of you, but can you bless us with some of your spoken word?
Most definitely. Let's I'd like to read something, probably, if that's okay. I'll do Manifesting Dreams, because that's the point in our life that we're at right now. The beauty in life comes in art, a perception of light. The mind adapts and vision changes. Small synapses generate pictures. In an alternate reality, dreams come true again and again. When it happens for real, this manifestation is not pretend. Belief is understood and followed. Faith and strength are prayed for, spoken out to the universe verbally. Epiphanies are had, then recorded with colors, sacred and appropriately. It happens accurately. Then another vision compounds and it happens instantly, back to a spatial universal anomaly. We dream again. We dream again.
Yes.
Then we have to wait patiently. And then it's worked for, and it's written down after it works, and it's listened to and taught. We hear it, we feel it. It's even more than it seems. Become it and do it, and I'm manifesting dreams.
Woo! Ah! Love it. Oh my God.
Yes. That one. Thank you.
Love it.
Awesome. I like that. And for those of you who are watching to Facebook, Marlon sent me a message that I was frowning. I wasn't frowning. That's just my Trenton face. Walk around to the Trenton, you got to have a Trenton face. That was awesome. So I hear you have a CD and a book out. So tell us the process, because we're about to start up the Author's Corner again. The next show, we're going to have an author come on the show. So tell us your process that you went through and any obstacles that you went through publishing your book. What's the name of your book?
I have The Color of My Sky is Black.
Okay. I like that.
The foundation, honestly, comes from trying to give Indigenous and Black males empowerment. We're torn down in society, we're marginalized, and every person needs to understand their own power. So I try to give people a glimpse into the actual inside of a male and Black African American male, and how it can empower us if you use what you have and use what you know So that's where I tried to come from with that. The obstacles with it was honestly just publishing it. I write every day. I write all the time. I love to write. It's one of my most therapeutic and favorite things to do. So it wasn't ever about getting content. It was about bringing something together and to uplift and reach the purpose that I wanted for, which I feel like, you know, is impoverished part of society.
Now, I noticed that, okay, as you're telling us about your book and your project, and as I listen to the spoken word, you know, you have a deep voice. And, you know, and basically to awaken the inner spirit to, you know, to be more fulfilling and fulfill purpose.
Yes.
Now, in writing so deeply, do you have different rituals, or what do you do before you get started? Do you meditate? Do you do yoga? You know, what inspires you to just sit down and start writing? What do you do before you put, you know, pen to paper or type on a computer? Is there something that you do all the time before you start writing?
Yes. One of the first thing I do is I actually don't know why it became a part. I didn't always use it, but I stimulate the olfactory sense. So I'll light some incense or some Palo Santo, and then I always choose a color. See, because I think a lot of people don't realize that they just start to write in whatever pen they have. And most of the time it's black or blue. But one of the main things that I always do is I use colored pens and I pick a color. And so with that color will emanate an energy to you, because that's how our minds are based. You know, through the sight. And that's why I wrote that poem the way I did, Manifesting Dreams. It's about how the mind is shaped. And you know, so colors emanate light, and each light has its own properties. And so when you're writing with a certain particular color, whatever it is, you're going to receive some of that energy from that color. And that's one of the main things that I try to give to people as a hint to maybe that'll help them with a mind block if they have, or a writer's block, is use a different color. So I never have a mind.
It's interesting you say that, because as soon as you said, you know, a color or, you know, things of that nature, it reminded me of Bradbury Theater. And I don't know, you're probably too young, because he was one of those horror film writers, you know. He wrote, and he has a segment that still comes on TV today, Bradbury Theater. And he has this, I'm like, spooky as hell. He has an office, and he has monsters and different things. And he said all he does is he just looks around, and something will catch his eye, and that's what he'll start writing about. So I kind of, you know, like what you said, you know, you're being inspired by color. And awesome. Now,
I love that, and I love that idea. And everyone knows I've been trying to do a book for years, and so this year I'm like, this is it. So I've been writing, but some days it is a struggle, or then I skip a week. So I thank you for that tidbit. I'm definitely gonna try it.
Awesome.
Well, see, today I had the color of my eye. I wrote a poem today about I couldn't open a container to eat my lunch. So I wrote this poem and I made a video. See, I would post it for you, but my sister would probably kill me. I can give y'all a little tidbit of my poem. See, I gotta see family shares poetry. See, I got a little poet in me.
Yes.
Listen, it's a good poem. Wait, I brought myself a new container and I tried to heat up my lunch. I brought myself a new container, but this damn thing won't let me eat my lunch. It sealed itself shut. What can I do? I done banged it on the counter, tried to pry it open with a knife. But oh my goodness, this container isn't being nice. I brought myself a new container to heat up my lunch. I guess this container ain't for the fat. It must be diet proof. I'm throwing this sucker back. That's my poem. Thank you.
Yes.
Oh my God. One of her hidden talents.
Just getting it out. But see, it starts with what y'all were talking about at the very beginning, you know, getting out these emotions. It's very, very important. We learn in therapy, the first thing you have to do is accept, right? That's the main thing, is accept whatever it is. And part of accepting is acknowledgement. That's a foundation part of accepting, is acknowledgement. So when you get things out, you might inspire someone else. You know, you might have given someone else another way, or even a thought about it. And that happens all the time. That's why it's important not to stay in our own heads, but to, you know, like you were saying, Gail, to let it out and get it out from you, and then, you know, the universe will shape it.
Yeah. I wish the universe would have shaped that container so I could have ate my lunch. I know I'm going back to it, but I spent a half an hour trying to get the thing open. I made the video. I sent it to my sisters. My one sister's like, what is it? She couldn't. Oh, my gosh. See, I told her. I had to videotape it because nobody would believe that my container wouldn't let me eat my lunch. That's all I was saying. We got to let it out. If I let it out, I'll share my video. I will play it for y'all. You know what? I might post it for y'all on the page. The container. So I encourage anybody on a diet to go get this container. It wouldn't let me eat my lunch.
See, I think I need one.
No, but what you said is so true. Like, I mean, I do often sometimes when I'm going through some things, I do write down in a journal. I journalize some things. I don't do it as often as I used to. But like, I love writing down certain things. Sometimes I do turn it into poetry. Sometimes I just turn it down to how I feel. But it allows me to express myself without any judgment, without anybody. And even if I did want to read it, well, y'all know I don't care anyway. So, but I just feel like a pencil and a pad can be your freedom and instruct, you know, to acknowledge, you know, you could put it down on a piece of paper at that time and enjoy just going back and reading it. And you know, you can do what you want, but thank you, Rel. That was awesome, you know? And how can we get in touch with you? How can we get in touch?
Wait a minute, before he answers that question, I have a very important question to ask him. So what do you prefer? Do you prefer pen and paper or your computer? Or typewriter?
Myself is pen and paper.
Yeah, me too. Okay. Yeah, I like pen and paper too. I don't know why. Maybe because I'm old school. You know, even reading a book, Marzina, she tried to get me to read on, you know, a book on a tablet. And I did for a long time. But it's just, you know, it's just pen and paper. It's just a feel of paper. You know, I have that too. So go ahead, Marlon. What were you going to ask him?
So I was just going to ask if people want to get in touch with you, maybe purchase your CD, your book, or, you know, just reach out if they're in the Los Angeles area, you know, maybe to reach out to you to maybe for you to help them train them. How can they get in touch with you?
They could do email, and it's urelriley@gmail.com, or they could call me. I have 3 numbers. Put that out there. But yeah, I could give them one of the numbers and they could contact me. I normally have two of my phones with me most of the time. So,
so how about we do this? We'll put your contact in, give it to Marlon. We'll put your contact information on our page and we're just going to keep it moving. But definitely, we're going, like I said, we're going to be doing the Writer's Corner more often. We do have another author coming on in 2 weeks. And I kind of just a little bit helped her with the process, just a little bit, you know, influenced her. But yeah, she's written a children's book. So so we're going to have that. I think that's what, the 22nd, November 22nd. And then I'm going, since I'm retired.
Yeah, congratulations. Wow. That's awesome.
No, since I'm, you know, I'm going to, I also know a publisher. So I'm going to reach out to her. And I did have this discussion with her before, but now we're going to move forward. So 2021 is the time for releasing, birthing projects, Marzina. Okay, this is, it's going to be 2021, so get ready. I'm even looking at getting the other two done. I do have a heads up of an illustrator, so we're going to move forward. And I'm thanking God for, in Jesus' name, we're going to be moving forward in the things that we destined to do. We have our gifts, we have our talents. It is time for us to start moving in purpose. It's like, Urel, and I'm getting the feeling with you, Urel, that you are walking in purpose.
Yes. That, you know? I only let the Most High guide me. That's how I made it out here. And Marlena tell you all the way from Jersey to Berlin, Glassboro. And then I went to Florida. I was in Florida, Tampa Bay, St. Petersburg. And then I flew over and was in Africa and in Libya and then in Istanbul, Turkey, all the while doing the same things I do now. It's just that I was refining it. And like you said, staying in purpose. One of the main things that helps me always keep that sight of where I'm going is knowing that purpose. My dad always would say, when you go out the house, make sure you know where you're going. You know,
and I can back that up. My uncle does say that.
Yep.
You can back it up. But we really enjoyed talking to you. Like, on behalf of our family, thank you. Our sister dog family, thank you. And on behalf of your mom and dad, we're glad you keep on manifesting and growing in your life. And maybe one day we'll have you back on the show so that you can bless us with some more of your spoken word. And we hope that your businesses continue to grow.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much. I just, because the your healing is something that's going to be for the world. I've done it on 8-year-olds all the way up to 93-year-olds. And so that's what I feel like my purpose is to bring a different type of healing to the world. And so I'm trying to continue to get that out there. I want to get a wellness center so that people can start to come in and get these different treatments, you know, because on this road, I've learned so much and I just want to share it.
Well, we appreciate it.
I appreciate you. Thank you so much.
That's what I say a lot. People, we don't need to hold on so tight to the information that we have. We need to build each other up and lend a helping hand. Why not? Like, yeah, you're wonderful.
Oh, thank you.
And again, show us your book, around. Hold up your book for us again.
Yes, The Color of My Sky is Black.
Absolutely.
And it's just like I said, it's to try to give help and hope to our people first and foremost, just because the demonization, like Joe Biden had said, you know, it's been going on for so long. And I mean, I know you guys know the statistics. We're down to 13% in America. And most of them are beloved women. You know, our men are incarcerated and you know, 6 feet deep for the most part, you know. So I'm just trying, I want to keep, and I really appreciate you guys from giving light. And Marlene, this is one of the funniest people I've ever encountered in our family. I've always told her that. And that is that light, you know, laughing is healing. And that's a part of the process. So I just salute you guys, Gail, Z, Marlene. Thank you so much for having me on.
We really appreciate
it. Thank you for being on the show. You know what? You've really inspired me to start putting pen and paper again and get it moving. Since I have all this time, because I am
you tired.
You know what I'm talking right now?
I'm sorry. What'd you say, Marzina?
I said, do you know how you're making me feel right now?
Oh, you know what? Good, because you're in control and you're going to be prepared for 2021. It's right around the corner, and it doesn't take much to get published. It really doesn't. So if anybody who wants to get published, please stay tuned with us, because we are going to provide an environment where people can get information on birthing their book. It's time.
Well, I do want to tell y'all, I'm working on a project too in regards to authors. I'm not writing anything, but I'm working on something. Me and Ruben discussed it. I'm hoping it's going to manifest. And I'm going to keep y'all all, but it's going to be something great. I'm telling you, it's going to be great. Ruben can tell you, it's going to be great.
Well, you know what? We don't even need to think if it happens. That's we're right. going to declare when. And decree that it's going to happen.
That's right. It's when it happens.
Yes.
Because that's it. You have no choice.
Marlon, that's right. Tell her. She has no choice.
If you don't do it, no one else is going to. You got to think of it like that. That's how I try to think of it.
Be careful who you tell it to, because somebody will steal dream. We talked about that before. Dream stealer. Mm-hmm. So that's another show of Sister. So I just want to thank you again, Urel, for being on the show. Sharing and inspiring me. I don't know about them, but inspiring me to get back to
God bless.
So thank you for everything. Thank you so much. And please, we definitely have to have you on the show, because your journey is not ending. See, I just spoke a prophetic word. Your journey is you got more. You got there's more. How about that? Yes.
Yes. Thank you. And I receive.
Stay blessed and keep your head up.
Thank you. God bless.
Okay. Ruben?
All right.
Awesome lady.
Good show. Don't
stop. I think you're supposed to be real.
I know. I was caught up.